Thanks, Dave. Yeah, I was just speaking with David Lee about this, co-founder and CEO of Hesai Technology, about the analogies you might want to use in this situation. And I just taught you a new term, which is hard launch, and that's exactly what you've done with Nvidia, because it seems like you guys have actually been working on this for quite a while.
Yeah, exactly. So the news came out yesterday about Nvidia. To me, it's like we use analogies. It's almost like I've been secretly dating a supermodel for a long time. Even when I tell people, they're like, no, I don't believe you, right? Of course, the news is official. Now people know that we're officially on the new Hyperion platform, which is extremely exciting, definitely for us, and I think it's also great for the OEM customers who are interested in taking the NVIDIA solution. Here's the reason why it's very, very important. It used to be that when OEMs think about an autonomous driving product, you chop that into sections of the software, the hardware, the data, and the training and everything, right? And then you think magically they will be put together and it will work. Well, it turns out it's a little more complex than that. So now NVIDIA has this entire platform who has all the proven already working with vendors like us and the suppliers. It's an ecosystem. So now the OEMs will know when they pick this solution, they don't have to redo the hardware. They don't have to retrain the model because the data is there. So it's making things extremely simple and streamlined, and also low risk because it's proven.
We saw that share price move off the back, but can you just quantify it for us? What's the actual size of this opportunity for you? What does it actually mean in financial terms?
We actually don't know how big this could be, but I'll give you some numbers to justify that. First of all, China market is anywhere between 25 to 28 million cars, but the global is more than 80 million. So that's a factor of roughly three. And also on the product side, the global OEMs tend to think more higher end, more advanced, higher quality parts. And that also gives you an extra benefit of being able to work with customers globally. So if you multiply them, it's actually a much, much bigger market than China alone. That's why people are more excited about it.
Obviously, we're in Las Vegas, and it's a huge automotive market in North America as well. But how do you think about the opportunity here, particularly, of course, you guys have faced tensions with Washington as well?
Definitely. Well, there isn't a perfect solution to fully solve that problem, but here's what we have done, right? The first of all, we publicly announced also at Bloomberg that we are in the process of building a factory at Thailand, and which will be in production early 2027. And that is going to be our new manufacturing facility to support the demand from the global OEM side. At the same time, we're also building advanced products for those platforms that the global OEM is requiring, because they're doing long-range, high-definition level 3 applications, which we're also super excited about. And also in the meantime, of course, it's a necessary step for us to make sure that we're fully compliant with all the regulatory effort, including on the hardware side, on the data side, and also on the software side. For the software, most people think LiDAR has software, but actually, by the regulatory definition, we have firmware, which is the software you use to control the device, but there's no data, no AI in it, to make sure it's compliant everywhere.
So China manufacturing for China and Thailand for...
Global, China for China.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. And what's the breakdown then, do you anticipate? What are you actually expecting to get out of that Thailand factory?
Today, as I said, it's still mostly China because the Thailand is not ready yet. And also, quite honestly, China EV has been leading the global market on the volume and also on the product side. Mm-hmm. But in the end, we do expect a more balanced mix between China and Europe and US and a lot of the third world countries.
You are the world's biggest LiDAR maker, and your market presence is felt. I know, for instance, RoboSense is another one of your peers in China. They actually had to pivot some of their business away to try and capture new markets, just given the heft of Hesai. But what about in the US market? Because Luminar is another company that recently actually declared bankruptcy. So who do you see as your competitors, and what are the pressures that you see on that front as well?
The competition is always going to be there because LiDAR is a super important product and the market is massive. I think some people half jokingly say our biggest competition is from the people who don't want to use LiDARs. I feel like that's more important for us to make sure we convince those people. And today, we want to do that via data, right? And Hesai has shipped more than 2 million units from the past few years. And most of them are saving lives. Like, we already have public statement from the CEO of some of our customers saying that in critical cases, fatal accidents, LiDAR could save up to 90%. So we want people to look at the data. That's one thing, safety. The other thing is we want people to look at how far we have gone in reducing the price, because in the end, it's a return and it's an investment. If you remember from 5-8 years ago, that was $50,000 per LiDAR. Now it's below $200. We feel like we've done a great service to the industry by making this reliable, effective, life-saving sensor affordable.
Now that you get to that price point, you also open up new opportunities and new markets, because you're not talking about a car that's, say, $50,000, $60,000, $70,000. You're talking about maybe a humanoid robot that's far cheaper. So what are the opportunities you see outside the EV space?
That's great. First of all, there isn't really a case where if you fail in automotive, you can pivot to be successful in other markets. Here's why. In the end, they leverage the same capability. It's a manufacturing, it's a vertical integration, it's a globalization, it's the ability to control the cost. They actually are the same. So for us, we're lucky that we build the strong capability from automotive, and especially China automotive, which is super competitive. And then we leverage that to products outside automotive. We're on a humanoid for sure, but I don't know about being cheaper for those products. And we are on all the robotaxis for sure. And also we're on all different crazy applications. One of them is lawnmowers, which is actually affordable. It's like 800 euros or so, right? Now you can buy an 800 euro autonomous lawnmowers in Europe with our sensor on it. So you don't have to bury the wire, you don't have to do all the crazy things, and it will just mop your lawn very, very quickly. So those are some of the applications we're looking at. But in the end, we're not tailoring a product for the market. We use the standardized technology and product, and we cater to tons of different robotics applications where we feel like we can empower all of them, and the volume, the margin of that business will eventually be bigger than cars.